Voices of Revolt, Speeches of Ferdinand Lassalle. Voices of Revolt, Volume 3, Asterisk, Speeches of Ferdinand Lassalle with a biographical sketch. New York International Publishers, Superior 19SY by International Publishers, LN, printed in the USA. This book is composed and printed by Union Labor. Ferdinand Lassalle, introduction. At the beginning of the modem German labor movement stands Lassalle. One, he was the sword, he was the flayer. Hart Hauptmann's words concerning Florian Geyer are just as appropriate to the first leader of the industrial proletariat. An ardent sense of right course through his veins. His burning sense of justice dragged him by way of Fichte and Hegel into the domain of Karl Marx, made him the awakener of the German workers and the most fiery sounder of the tocsin in the struggle for liberation by the proletariat. Lassalle was not a Prussian and not a Bavarian. He was a German and a Jew and a revolutionary into the bargain. This day, each of these three attributes is a curse for those that have been born between the Moselle and the Memel and are condemned to live and work in this territory. This is perhaps not the least of the reasons for that portion of the politics and tactics of Lassalle that has always remained foreign and inaccessible to us. Let us not dwell here on time-honored disputed questions. We know how Marx and Engels judged Lassalle, but we also know that the writers of the 9-10 introduction Communist Manifesto in this relation frequently overshot the mark. Franz Mehring has given an exhaustive treatment of the subject, and even Karl Marx in a letter to the Countess has felt, written by Marx after Lassalle's death, makes the following admission. You are quite right in your suggestion that no one was better equipped than I to appreciate the great and significant qualities in Lassalle, but altogether apart from this equipment of mine, I love him personally. The unfortunate thing always was that we continually concealed our affection for each other as if we were destined to live forever. In another letter written by Marx to J.B. von Schweitzer, Marx eulogizes Lassalle for having reawakened the German workers' movement to life after a slumber of 15 years, in spite of any tactical errors he might have made in the course of his propaganda work. The most adequate estimate of Lassalle, of his mistakes and errors, is that afforded by Franz Mehring in his Geschichte der deutschen Sozialdemokratie, Vol. 2, E247. Lassalle was a convinced communist in the sense of the Communist Manifesto, and his many errors and miscalculations were due only to the fact that he translated the economic conceptions of the manifesto into legal and philosophical terms before put one in his Geschichte der deutschen Sozialdemokratie. His social forces in German history, Y.Y. and D. Riesenokes, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. Introduction 11. Kingdom to his own uses. Owing to the fact that he understood the proletarian class struggle, the worship of the state carried on by our classical philosophy could not possibly attain the formalistic rigidity which it developed under the hands of Robert Deuce. But since Lassalle never completely abandoned the idealistic modes of thought, he was never able to relinquish the cult of the state. There is no doubt that he felt far more secure on legal and philosophical ground than in the economic field. It would be an exaggeration to declare, as do some, that he had made no real independent study of the subject. His studies in this field were so real and so effective that a whole university full of academic bigwigs might find adequate material for investigation in his work. But he did not dominate the field with the sure mastery of a Marx or an Engels, since his idealistic formulas of thought too frequently impeded his path. In the press of battle, he would then resort to whatever weapons were at hand. Following the theory of Lessing's old dictum, it is not he that made the ladder, but he that ascends and will scale the wall, and even an unsafe ladder will support a bold and agile man. No doubt the bourgeois economists are right in maintaining that Lassalle was not an epoch-making socialist theorist. If only these moles who feel so much at home in the dark had also an eye for what is to be seen in the light of day. 12. Introduction to Lassalle's idealism was his weakness. It also constituted his strength. It was this idealism which imparted to him his rock-bound confidence in the power of the ideal, a confidence that enabled Lassalle to produce such great results. It may be necessary to state in advance that Lassalle did not appreciate so keenly and profoundly the laws of motion and evolution of modern bourgeois society as did Marx and Engels, yet it would be an error to attempt to estimate Lassalle's historical importance exclusively by this criterion in any other field than in the case of the defect which is mentioned. Such a procedure would be equivalent to regarding historical problems as classroom exercises, or such exercises need only be gone through to discover their error. Every historical character finds his historical justification only by reason of his historical environment. If we compare Lassalle with Marx and Engels, who grew up under quite different historical conditions, he may in a certain sense be overshadowed by these two men, if only for the reason that the path of his life was beset with darker shadows than theirs. But if we compare him with his contemporaries living in about the same or even more favorable circumstances, let us say, for instance, with the young Hegelians in the philosophical field, with Robert Deuce in the economic field, with Johann Jacobi in the political field, gains immensely in breadth and in introduction 13. In spite of the idealistic Weltanschauung which he had in common with these men, he was able to penetrate to the core of scientific communism, and none of these men did that thanks to his great mental gifts, thanks to his revolutionary instincts, and also more particularly thanks to his honest and untiring wish for the truth. Lassalle's errors were therefore not only inherent in the character of the great agitator, they were in part the product of the political and economic circumstances prevailing at the time in Prussia and Germany, where it was the agitator's most prominent duty to engage in practical work and struggle. The French bourgeoisie succeeded in putting through its claims in the Great Revolution of 1789. The German bourgeoisie arose after the defeat of 1806 and after the so-called Wars of Liberation, which smoothed it away simultaneously for an economic revival as well as for a hale and hearty infantile reaction. Accordingly, the year 1848 in Germany was but a faint echo of the French Revolution. When Lassalle entered the lists, a dream of German unity of 1848 which had been swiftly dissipated lay behind him. Hell Pashas were cavorting about on their wooden horses and spurring them on against Bismarck, and everywhere the men of progress or Schwarzenegger were bustling and busying about the June bugs of the springtime of the NA-14 introduction. Just as Heinrich Heine once called, the bourgeoisie was incapable of recognizing its own historical mission, to say nothing of carrying it out. It permitted its princes and diplomats, after the wars they had forced upon it, wars of X864, 1866 and X871, confer upon it through the revolution from above what it should have acquired for itself in its own class interest from below. In 1848, against the opposition of the Prussian junkers and the German princes, the immediate consequence was the black, red, and white empire of the Hohenzollerns, the ultimate disaster, a defeat in the World War. The German workers at that time stood in the ranks of the so-called progressives. It was Lassalle's accomplishment to have cut them off from this connection and made them independent by the forming of the Allgemeine Deutsche Arbeiterverein, the General German Workers Union. It was the tragedy of his position to have suffered from the delusion, in spite of this great task and in spite of all his theoretical knowledge, that he might make use of the working class to force the bourgeoisie also to discharge its historical mission. How can anyone oblige John Quincy, a carpenter, to be a true lion, or all the lion skin he may drape about him? How can anyone force a Democratic Secretary of War to be a Republican in spite of his black, red, and gold cockade? Introduction 15. It is the cruel irony of our period, in which falls the 100th anniversary 1925 of the birth of Lassalle, that it repeats on a more disastrous, on a more all-embracing scale, the same political events, the same political relations, and the same political parties as prevailed in the days of Lassalle's fiery activity. His speeches are therefore as if they had been pronounced yesterday. One need only to change a few figures and names, the rest remains the same. The parties and their leaders have merely moved up a few seats, and the progressives of Lassalle are the social democrats of today. General suffrage right is no longer a battle's love. The reactionary forces are perfectly well able to live with, and by the aid of the bourgeois democracy, Lassalle is no longer proscribed. On the contrary, he has been elevated to the position of an economic theorist, with the assistance of whose alleged doctrines the German worker is fed the saccharine half of human kindness. In reproducing in the following pages a few thoughts taken from those of Lassalle's speeches which are valid even today, we are pursuing the object of calling to account all those unclean elements who, like the social democrats on the occasion of their 100th anniversary of his birth, make use of his name for impure ends as a means of cloaking their policy and their hostility to the cause. Lassalle was different from his present-day inheritors. His X16 introduction prescience were different from theirs. He died young in battle, as Achilles was Karl Marx's lament on Lassalle. From London, his successors, they are accumulating adipose tissue and rotting on the unclean couch of bourgeois coalitions. It is as if Lassalle had never lived and had never shouted to the workers, "The proletariat alone is the rock on which the church of the future shall be founded." Now, as then, the question of a proletarian revolution is the truly national question, and no duty is therefore more imperative than that of freeing the working class from all bourgeois illusions and leading them into the class struggle, into the revolution, to serve the purpose of bringing about an understanding of the true Lassalle. These pages have been compiled, where it was Lassalle who once said to one of his adherents after the delivery of a speech at Frankfurt, "Whenever I say general suffrage right, you must understand me as meaning revolution and revolution and again revolution." It is this Lassalle whom the progressives hated like sin. It is this Lassalle whom they denounced as an agent of the reaction, as a Caspar of Bismarck. Progressives, all politiker, compromisers and the dupes of conciliation were his contemporaries may be found again in this volume. We see rising before us the complete political slough of despond of that period, the same miserable subterfuges and follies, the same clowns and millennia. Introduction 17. Prophets. As we find today, is not much difference between 1848 and 1918. The counter-revolution of the former year is remarkably similar to that of the latter year. Furthermore, we find the proletariat faced with the same tasks and duties, and therefore we again find the Lassalle whom we love, or he beat the drum on the march of revolution. He was the sword, he was the flame. AKOB Altmaier. Speeches of Ferdinand Lassalle to the German workers. You German workers are funny fellows. When one addresses meetings of French and English workers, one tells them how they may remedy their sad situation, but in talking to you, one must first make you see that your situation is a sad one. As long as you still have a piece of cheap sausage and a glass of beer, you are blind to your surroundings and do not even know that there is anything wrong. This is what comes of this damn frugality of yours. How will be your answer is not frugality a virtue? No doubt in the eyes of the Christian preachers of morals, no doubt frugality is a virtue. Frugality is a virtue of the Hindu saint on his pillar and of the Christian monk. The virtue that is appreciated by the historian and the political economist is a far different one. Ask any political economist what is the greatest misfortune of a people, and he will answer: be over frugal in its requirements, for its needs and requirements are the goads to its evolution and culture. 1920 Lassalle. The virtue of the present day, the day of political economy, is to have as many needs as possible and to fulfill them in an honest and decent manner. Until you understand this fact, I shall have preached to you in vain. I from a speech delivered at Frankfurt on the May 71, 1863. Not deceived, you are being deceived, trade gentlemen. When you speak of the situation of the workers and of improving the situation, you mean your situation as compared with that of your fellow citizens at the present moment, compared in other words with the general level of the standard of life in the same epoch. And you are being edified with alleged comparisons between your situation and that of the workers in former centuries. But whether the workers, in view of the alleged rise in the habitual requirements of life, there has been any improvement in the minimum of such requirements, are better off today than were the workers 80, 200, 300 years ago. Of what value is this question to you, and what satisfaction can it afford you? It is as little a source of gratification as the doubtless accepted fact that you are better off than the vodkudos and other men-eating savages who are living at the present time. Every human situation, of course, always depends only on the relation of the means of satisfying a demand to the requirements habitually made at a 21-22 speeches of certain epoch, or what amounts to the same thing, on the surplus of the means of satisfaction beyond the lowest limit of the requirements of life habitually advanced at a certain epoch. An enhanced minimum of the lowest demands of life will also provide sufferings and privations which were unknown in earlier days. What does the vodkudo suffer for not being able to buy so? What does the man-eating savage suffer when he is unable to buy a decent coat? What did the worker suffer before America was discovered and he was unable to smoke tobacco? What did the worker suffer before printing was invented because he was unable to provide himself with a certain useful good? All human sufferings and privations ever depend exclusively on the ratio between the means of satisfying demands and the needs and habits of life already present. All human sufferings and privations and all human situations, in other words, any human situation whatever, may therefore be measured only by means of a comparison with the situation in which other persons of the same epoch are situated with regard to the habitual needs of life. Any situation of a class is always measured therefore by its relation with the situation of the other classes at the same time. If it were proved beyond the possibility of contradiction that the level of the necessary conditions of life at the various epochs shows an enhancement, Lassalle 23, that situations formerly unknown have now become an habitual requirement, and that for this very reason sufferings and privations hitherto unknown have also become current. Your human situation has always remained the same in all these epochs, namely you have continued to wallow about along the lower edge of the necessities of life habitually required at any epoch, sometimes a little above it, sometimes a little below it. From Offen's Antwort Schreiben. You open reply. Starvation and starvation. The families of 5 persons that live on less than $2 annually per family, in other words, families that are living no doubt in real want, or at least are very poor, constitute 95.7% of the population. Yes, gentlemen, the number is concealed from you in order to conceal from you your power, or you lack none of the elements of power but consciousness. For this reason, there is everywhere a conspiracy against you for the purpose of falsifying these facts and figures. Starvation, gentlemen, is a word that may be taken in a double sense. Actual cases of people falling down in the street and dying instantly of hunger are quite unusual. Are cases of persons continually giving forth more energy than they are capable of replacing by reason of a deficiency of foodstuffs or too low a standard of living, in other words, an expenditure of strength exceeding the requisites of strength. Such cases also mean ultimate starvation. The latter process of starvation lasts long enough to enable one to put children into the 24 Lassalle 25 world. Thus, the population is increased, particularly that of the working classes, and yet a process of starvation remains in force. Some from the Arbiter Lesbuch and Workers Reader Unclear Thinkers AIR underscore periods of history unite in affording frequent repetitions of the spectacle of unclear thinkers, which class, gentlemen, may also include ostensibly highly cultured persons such as professors and others, as the St. Paul's Church of Lamentable Memory has shown, who contract the unhappy delusion of mistaking a comparatively consistent and clear expression of the thought of a declining epoch or institution for a new revolutionary principle. It is against such persons and tendencies, which are revolutionary only in their own conceit, that I should like to warn you, gentlemen, or we shall have as little lack of them in the future as we have had in the past. But we may console ourselves simultaneously with the thought that the numerous movements which collapse immediately or but a short time after their momentary success, which we find in history and which might fill the well meaning but superficial heart of many a friend of the people with real concern, were revolutionary movements that were revolutionary only in their own fantasy. A truly revolutionary movement, a movement resting on a truly new principle of thought, has, as the 28 Lassalle 27 profound thinker may learn to his solace from history, never been destroyed, at least never permanently, from the Arbiter program, workers program. A speech delivered in Berlin April 2, 1986 to the press. A far more discouraging symptom of the complete dissolution and decay of the Progressive Party is the press. I am here touching upon a point of the greatest importance, and I regret that in spite of the great detail with which I shall treat it, is impossible to treat it with the detail it deserves. One thing you must bear in mind constantly, must disseminate constantly: our principal enemy, the principal enemy of any healthy development of the German spirit and of the German people, is today the press. The press, at the stage in its evolution which it has now reached, is the true enemy of the people, an enemy all the more dangerous by reason of its many disguises. Its lying, its corruption, its immorality are exceeded by no other quality, unless perhaps by its own ignorance. The duplicity of this press was perhaps best brought home to you by its struggle against our organization, and yet very few of you know even a small fraction of the truth of the situation. Daily new lies, lies by means of pure fact alone, lies by means of invented facts, lies by means of facts distorted into their opposites. Such were the weapons with which we were fought. And to cap the climax, 28 Lassalle 29 of the shame, the newspapers in most cases even refused to print a correction. The pinnacle of this outrage is in the fact that the newspapers themselves not easily admit that the principal motive for their silence was their financial interest. It was the Rhenes Zeitung, that unworthy namesake of two great organs which were published in the Rhineland in 1843 and in 1848, and which were an honor to their country. It was the Rhenes Zeitung, I say, which led the band in this naive exposure. How can people expect to cry when a loud murmur among the Progressive Party itself became audible over the cowardice of the newspaper underscorers? How can people expect the publishers to risk the capital which they have invested in the paper? To be sure, nothing is more sacred than the publisher's capital. In fact, with the aid of that shameless process of distorting all conceptions which has so long been the prerogative of our newspapers, it was now argued that it was the actual duty of the newspapers to venture no money loss, or for God's sake jeopardize the sacred capital of the publishers. It is as if a soldier and the newspapers ought to be soldiers, champions of liberty, and claim to be such, should regard it as his first duty under no circumstances to expose himself to the danger of being hit by a bullet. These are grave, very grave conditions, and with my soul full of sadness, I do not hesitate to say that 30 speeches of, unless a complete transformation of our press can be accomplished, if this newspaper pestilence shall continue for 50 years more, the intelligence of our people will be ruined and destroyed to its depths. But you must understand that if thousands of newspaper writers cease out today, teachers of the people are permitted to spread their stupid ignorance, their conscientiousness, their eunuch's hatred for everything that is true and great in politics, art, and science, and to breathe the spirit into a people which gullibly and confidingly opens its ears to this poison which is disseminated by hundreds of thousands of voices because it hopes to imbibe mental nourishment from our national intelligence, will necessarily be destroyed, even if it were three times as well established as it is. Not even the most talented nation in the world, not even the ancient Greeks, could have survived such a press. And you must understand that even though there may not be 5 or 10 or a dozen serious and intelligent an honest man among the span. This fact could alter nothing in what I have said, since the sounds of their voices will die away without an echo in the roar and babble of their colleagues. A man who wishes to make money should manufacture cotton or cloth or play on the stock exchange, but to poison all the wells of popular instruction for the sake of filthy gain, feed the people a spiritual death daily from 1,000 tubes. Lassalle 81. This is the greatest crime that I can conceive of, a true enemy of the people, its most dangerous enemy, a more dangerous, since it masquerades in the disguise of a friend, is our present day press. Let me prevail upon you to cling with ardent enthusiasm to the slogan which I now ask you to make your own: hatred and contempt, death and destruction. The press of today, from Die Fazi Press Menti to Frankfurter ab Jordan Tenta, youth festivals of press and the Congress of Deputies at Frankfurt, a speech delivered at the meetings of the Allgemeine Deutscher Arbeiterverein at Barmen, Solingen, and Dusseldorf, September 261, 271, and 28. R86J, artificers of the Constitution. VHEN, is a written constitution a good one and a permanent one? Obviously, only in the one case, gentlemen, when it corresponds to the true constitution, the real alignment of forces that obtains in the country. When the written constitution is not in agreement with the real constitution, there will be a conflict that cannot be remedied and that will necessarily result in the destruction of the written constitution, which is a mere sheet of paper, as opposed to the real constitution, the actual distribution of forces prevailing in the country. What should therefore have been done at that time? In the first place, it was necessary to make not a written constitution but a real constitutive, i.e., true alignment of forces in the country should have been changed, and changed to the advantage of the citizen. No doubt it had just become apparent on March 8, 1848, that the power of the people was already at that moment greater than the power of the standing arm. After a long and bloody struggle, the troops had been obliged to retire. 32 Lassalle 33. But I long ago pointed out to you the important relation existing between the power of the people and the power of the standing army, as a result of which the actually much smaller power of the standing army is in the long run nevertheless more effective than the actually greater might of the nation. This difference is due, if you will remember, to the fact that the power of the nation is an unorganized power, while the power of the standing army is an organized power which is daily available and ready to take up the struggle again, and which therefore in the long run is more effective and must be able to maintain the field against the greater but unorganized power of the people, which is capable of united action only in rare moments of great enthusiasm. Therefore, the victory gained on March 18th was not to be nullified without recall in its advantages for the people. A victorious moment should have been made use of in order to transform the organized power of the standing army in such a manner as to make it impossible for it ever to be used again as a mere instrument of force by the monarch against the people. It was necessary, furthermore, to provide that all the lower officers extending at least as high as major should not be appointed from above, but should be elected by the troops themselves, so that speeches of the posts of officers should not be held by persons hostile to the people, thus making it possible once more to transform the army into a blind instrument of anarchical power. In addition, the army should have been made subject to the regular civil courts except for specifically military offenses, so that by this means it might have been made a common possession of the people and not a thing standing apart, a separate caste. Besides, all the artillery cannons, which are of course useless except for the national defense, should have been placed in the custody of the municipal authorities elected by the people, except for such guns as were absolutely necessary for military maneuvers. A portion of this artillery should furthermore have been used in order to build up artillery sections of the national militia, thus putting the cannons, this very essential constituent of the constitution, under the power of the people. Of all this, gentlemen, nothing was done in the spring or in the summer of 1848, and can you marvel therefore that the March Revolution was again neutralized and deprived of its resources in November 1848? Surely you cannot. The latter step was merely a necessary consequence of the fact that no real change had been made in the actual alignment of forces. The princes, gentlemen, are far better served than you. The servants of the princes are not mere Lassalle 35 orators, as those of the people often are. They are practical men who know by instinct what is at stake. Surely Herr von Manschuffel was not a great orator, but he was a practical man. When he had dispersed the National Assembly and planted the artillery in the streets in November 1848, what did he do next? Did he begin by drawing up a reactionary constitution? God forbid, he had plenty of time for that. In December 1848, he even gave you a fairly liberal constitution, at least on paper. But what did he really set about doing in November? What was the first measure? Why, gentlemen, you must remember it very well. He began by disarming the people, by taking away their weapons. You see, gentlemen, the victor's chief concern is to disarm the vanquished, unless he wishes to see the battle renewed at any moment. I have just shown that in the year 1848 none of the measures was adopted which would have been necessary for the purpose of changing the actual relations of forces existing in the country, or of transforming the army from an army servants into an army serving the people. The making of a written constitution was the last consideration that may be done at any time in thrice 24 hours. That was the last thing that concerned anyone, and besides, the making of such a constitution too early was equivalent to doing nothing at all. 36 speeches of to transform the real actual relations of forces within the country, to intervene in the executive arm, and to intervene so thoroughly and remodel it so completely as to make it impossible for it ever again effectively to oppose the will of the nation. This was the task confronting the men of 1848, a task that had necessarily to be performed before a written constitution could offer any promise of durability. If you have in your garden an apple tree and proceed to hang on it a label which declares this is a fig tree, have you thereby transformed the tree into a fig tree? You have not. Even though you should gather all your servants and all the inhabitants of the country around and have them all declare aloud with due solemnity this is a fig tree, the tree will remain what it always has been, and when the next year comes around the truth will out, the tree will bear apples and not fig. Quite similar, as we have seen, is the case with the constitution. / B hat is written on the sheet of paper is of no value at all if it does not correspond to the real condition of affairs or the actual alignment of forces. On the scrap of paper of December 1848, the king had stated his acceptance of his own volition of a great number of concessions, all of which however were in contradiction with the true constitution, namely with the real actual instruments of Lassalle 81, power which the king held unabated in his hands. So the same necessity that may be observed in the operation of the law of gravity, real constitution, therefore carried off the victory by step over the written constitution. Therefore the king was obliged, although the constitution of December 1848 had been accepted by the revision committee at once, to undertake the first change, namely the three-class election law of 1849, which was arbitrarily interpolated in the constitution. With the aid of the chamber created by the election law, certain very essential changes in the constitution had then to be made, so that it might be sworn to by the king in the year XASO, and after he had sworn to it, then was the time for the changes really to begin. Every year since XASO has been marked by some such change. Even a flag that has passed through 100 battles cannot present so ragged and perforated an appearance as our constitution. From Uberber Festens Wiesen, concerning the theory of the constitution, a speech delivered at Berlin on April 6, 1867, the deliverers of the constitution, you know, gentlemen, there exists in our city a party whose organ is the Volkszeitung, a party, say, which in spite of its name rallies to this rag of an ensign, this ragged constitution of ours, a party which therefore arms itself the faithful to the constitution, and whose battle cry is, let us adhere to the constitution, or God save the constitution hell to the rescue. Fire, fire, gentlemen, whenever you behold a party arising, regardless of when and where, which makes its battle cry, the terrified shall rally round the constitution. What must be your inference in such case? I am asking you, gentlemen, not as men of action and will. My question is not directed to your volition. I am asking you solely as thinking men. What must be your inference from such a situation? Well, gentlemen, without setting yourselves up to be prophets, you will always be able to say with the utmost certainty in such cases, this constitution is at the last gasp. It is as good as dead. A few years more and it will no longer be in existence. The reasons are very simple. When a written constitution actually corresponds to the real line 38 Lassalle 89 meant of forces in the country, this cry will never be uttered. Such a constitution has the respectful adherence of everyone. No one would dare encroach upon it. No one would even think of coming to grips with such a constitution, or in such an encounter he would be surely worsted. Where the written constitution is in accord with the actual alignment of forces in the country, it would even be impossible for any party to make a special battle cry of the beauty of adhering to the constitution. When this cry is uttered, it is a sure and unmistakable sign that it is a shout of terror. In other words, that there is still some condition in the written constitution which contradicts the actual constitution, the actual situation of forces in the country. Once this contradiction is present, the written constitution is lost forever, and no god and no amount of shouting can be of any use. Such a constitution may suffer change in either direction, either to the right or to the left. It cannot be a permanent constitution. A very cry that it must be retained is evidence of this to any man of clear thought. It may be altered to the right by an effort on the part of the government to secure such alteration in order to bring the written constitution into agreement with the actual resources and strength of the organized power of society, or the unorganized power of society may make itself felt and prove once more that it is greater than the 40 speeches of organized powers. In this case, a constitution will be altered as far in the direction of the left as it would be altered in the previous case in the direction of the right. But in any case, it is a lost constitution. Gentlemen, if you will not only carefully bear in mind and think out the terms of the lecture which I have had the honor of delivering to you, but will apply it and develop it to its utmost consequences, you will have put yourselves in possession of the entire art and science of the constitution question. Constitutional questions are not fundamentally questions of right, but questions of mind. A true constitution of a country exists only in the real actual situation of forces prevailing in a country. Written constitutions are real constitutions and of permanent life only when they are the precise expression of the true situation of forces prevailing in society. These are the principles which you must bear in mind. I have developed these principles in your presence today only insofar as they apply to the armed forces in the first place, because the brevity of the time at my disposal has permitted only a limited application of these principles in the second place, because the army is the most decisive and the most important of all the organized instruments of force. You will understand by yourselves that the matter applies equally well to the organization of the officials of justice, of administer Lassalle 41 tip officials, etc. These are likewise organized instruments of power in certain societies. If you will bear this lecture in mind, gentlemen, you will know if ever again you should be in a position to write a constitution for yourselves what the necessary procedure must be, and will not content yourselves with filling sheets of paper with writing, but only with the real action of making genuine alterations in the actual situation of forces in the country. Holland from Uber Perfass Unsweet. No compromise. What will absolutism do if it has succeeded in putting through a victorious counter-revolution? Absolutism wants to continue in power. There is no doubt of this, but will it desire to maintain itself in its old form, namely as a naked, undisguised absolutism? Will it drop the constitution and continue to govern in the former absolutist method without any constitution at all? God forbid. Absolutism is not as stupid as that, for absolutism has reluctantly accepted the understanding having been once subjected to a defeat, which in our case is the defeat of March RA 1848, of the fact that the unorganized social power of the citizenry is, in the last analysis, far superior to absolutism, and absolutism may in a favorable hour, by virtue of the discipline of its organized forces, have defeated the citizenry, or the moment, but that the latter continued to be, while unorganized, nevertheless the socially predominant force. In other words, that a new conflict may arise at any moment in which absolutism will be defeated again, and if this defeat is better utilized by its adversary, this time forever. Absolutism, once having been made to feel the social power of the citizenry, now has at least some 42 Lassalle 43 obscure suspicion of the fact that as a man can beget only a man, an ape only an ape, and every creature therefore only a creature that shall resemble him, that shall be made in his image. So in the long run, the organized elemental power residing in society must inevitably have produced the organized power, the form of government, let us say, which will resemble it and be made in its image. Of all these things, absolutism has a more or less unclear notion. For after all, the men of the government are, as I have told you, practical men with an instinct for things as they are. No matter how intractable absolutism may pretend to be, it is by no means pleased by the precarious existence it leads in its present outright and open contradiction with the social alignment of forces, incurring at my moment the risk of being overwhelmed and crushed as if by an avalanche by the descent of these social forces. Absolutism therefore has only one means of maintaining its existence for a time, at least a figment of the constitution. As soon as absolutism has taken the step, namely that of an ostensible constitutionalism, it will have achieved a great advantage and prolonged its existence for an indefinite period. If absolutism should attempt to continue its existence in the old undisguised form, it could not count on any long life. Underscore the outright and open con 44 speeches of tradition between absolutism and the social condition would make its overthrow the unchanging and ever renewed slogan of society. All society in fact do nothing else by the very nature of the case itself and constitute one great conspiracy for the overthrow of its form of government. No government in the world could maintain such a situation for a very long time. A government may at a favorable moment hold together its army and carry out a successful attack, a successful counter-revolution, but its situation only becomes much more difficult when the government is the attack party, is acting on the defensive with the people, the attacker. The advantage in struggles of this kind is always on the part of the attacker, for the reason that it is he that has had the opportunity to choose the moment. It is for this reason that most of the coups d'etat carried out by governments in the present century have met with success, but then so have most of the revolutions on the part of the people. However, government may even be able to ward off for a certain time, for instance, for a few months, an attack which it expects the people to make upon, but it is a matter of the utmost difficulty for any government to remain armed for THJS encounter over long periods, keeping itself on a war footing for the purpose of warding off an attack which will probably be launched upon it at the most awkward moment when it is involved in other complications of the Lassalle 45 gravest nature. Such a situation is untenable for any government in the long run, and therefore almost inconceivable. But when an absolutist government has surrounded itself with the empty appearances of constitutional forms and proceeds to continue the practice of the ancient absolutism within these forms, it has carried off an immense advantage. For now, owing to the appearance of a favorably achieved balance between the form of government and the social group predominant in society, the latter has been lulled to sleep and satisfied for the moment. That which was to be fought for appears already to have been achieved. This illusion pacifies the struggle, repels it, and breaks its point by making great masses of the people either satisfied or indifferent and uninterested. From now on, only the forces operating unconsciously in society will in general work for an overthrow of the government, and not the real consciousness of society itself. Pseudo-constitutionalism is therefore, and it is very important for you gentlemen to understand this, by no means an achievement of the people one, but on the contrary, only an achievement of absolutism and the most essential means for prolonging the existence of the latter. Pseudo-constitutionalism therefore, as you will now have understood, is to be found in the fact that the government makes statements of what is not so. 46 speeches of that the government declares the state to be a constitutional state, while it is in reality an absolutist state. Pseudo-constitutionalism is the lie in the struggle with this lie, and with its might, true and obviously victorious instrument is necessarily the exposure of this lie. Proper tactic is simply to destroy the appearance which has made the continuation of the deceptive forms possible, and thus to cut them off from any misleading influence on Tom, Dick, and Harry. The proper procedure is to force the lie to take off its mask and to admit to all the world, even formally, that it is really an absolute government. I tell you that the diet must end. This is a weapon leading indomitably to a victory. Simply state the truth. All great political action consists in the stating of that which is, and begins with such a statement. All political pettifogging consists in concealing and cloaking that which is. As a matter of fact, gentlemen, I here could and perhaps ought to raise great political accusations if it were not for the fact that for the sake of our unit, consider it better to leave these things unsaid. For years down to the present day, and since the inception of the new era, leaders of the People's Party in the press, and even if I should carry my discretion so far as to mention no names, you could not help knowing that I have the so-called Lassalle 47 Volt Society in mind have been pursuing a method consisting absolutely in no other thing than in the statement of things that are not so. They have proceeded from the assumption that it is necessary to whitewash, keep secret, cloak things. According to their mind, it is necessary to persuade the government that it is a constitutional government to such an extent that the government will ultimately believe the statement itself. It is therefore their aim to transform the government by lie. But all true successes in life and in history may be attained only by a real transformation, a real plowing over of the soil, never by a transformation in words of fall. So these mental starlings have failed to understand that without any desire of their own, they have become men of the government, both in their choice of weapons as well as in the effect of these weapons. In their choice of weapons, or their weapons are the same as those we have become acquainted with in the absolutism that is disguised with a pseudo-constitutionalism, namely the stating of things that are not so. And likewise, with regard to the operation of these dot instruments, for these mental starlings have failed to understand that in order to impart to the government through the lies of their newspapers the idea that the government is a constitutional government, they have been obliged daily to preach the same lie to the people, and thus actually made the people believe these babes 48 speeches have been unable to understand. Moreover, that by these lies they have only been encouraging the government to continue along the path of pseudo-constitutionalism, a path made very smooth and easy by the work of our friends. And I may say that the government itself was much astonished at the prestige and the halo prepared for it, at the crown of glory of a new era which was pressed upon its undeserving beings to such an extent that the government has finally been able to make military demands. These unhappy men who preach daily in their leading articles against immorality did not grasp the fact that the lie is a profoundly immoral instrument which in the political struggle may indeed be of advantage to a Machiavellian art of government, but never to the people themselves. It is these mental defectives who are responsible in great measure for the fact that things have come to the pass to which they have come. It is they who, with the battle cry, men of honor, the ministers are men of honor, divide the ministers have driven the die by their leading articles to appropriate the provisional budget for the army organization demanded by the pseudo-constitutional Schwerin-Pateau cabinet, which at that time might easily have been reviewed. It is they who are responsible, therefore, for the fact that it was made possible at all to introduce the army organization bill and to place us now in the position of having Lassalle 49 to meet this grave conflict, a thing that would have been impossible without their granting the provisional budget. But let the dead past bury its dead. It is our duty, however, fight the more inexorably and more jealously in the S. Arius encounters of the press to prevent a policy of meretricious cloaking from depriving people of their rights. Once more, I have revealed to you the means which cannot fail to be followed by an unconditional and positive victory of the people. Work for this end, there must be a mutual interaction between the deputies and public opinion. Set up the means we have just discussed and make it an educational slogan disseminated by throughout the circle of your acquaintances in public and private places in the whole sphere of your activity. Consider every man either as a conscious or an unconscious opponent of the good cause. If he will not make use of this instrument, a method outlined to you is the only method within the Diet's power. For what others are at its disposal, it would obviously be a most lamentable, a most absurd illusion if the Diet should believe that by continuing in session and continuing to vote down other demands of the cabinet, even all the cabinet's demands, it will be able to put any compulsion on the cabinet. If the cabinet dares to tread underfoot, to trample on the first unquestionably 50 speeches of constitutional refusal on the part of the Diet and proceed as if the Diet did not exist, how will it be possible to make the second or third or fourth refusal on the part of the Diet more effective? As a matter of fact, government would merely form the habit of regarding inconvenient decisions of the Diet as not having been adopted at all. Both government and people would accustom themselves to this condition. A pleasant habit of disregarding the resolutions of the Diet would become a rooted one, and it would be more rooted among the people and not without reason than in the government. A Diet which would consent after its constitutionally adopted decisions had been trodden underfoot, continue to deliberate and go through the motions of legislation, continue playing its part with the government in this farce of pseudo-constitutionalism, would actually be making itself the government's worst accomplice, or it would thereby be making it possible for the government to annihilate the constitutional rights of the people in spite of the fact that the appearance of a constitutional form was being kept up. And the Diet would be more culpable in this procedure than the government, or there is far more guilt in my own representative, in the man who should defend my rights and who betrays them instead, and in my adversary himself. It would perhaps be even worse if the chamber should consent to introduce a so-called Lassalle 51 compromise. You must raise your voices particularly against such an eventuality. No compromise is conceivable on this question. If the Diet should consent to any form of compromise under these circumstances, this would no longer be a compromise and agreement. It would be a complete surrendering of the public law. It would amount to an installing in office of the Bismarckian diplomatic practice, whose watchword is as follows: when the government is in conflict with the constitutional right of the chambers, it is the Diet that must yield. You must therefore regard every man outright as a conscious or unconscious, and in the latter case even more dangerous enemy of the righteous cause. Who would here speak of compromise? Let us have no illusions therefore of conciliation. Gentlemen, you have now gathered sufficient experience to know what the ancient absolutism amounts to. Therefore let us make no new compromise with it. Let our watchword be our hands around his throat and his shoulders on the ground. Or was not what now? A second lecture on the nature of the constitution delivered at Berlin November 17, 1862. Coalition or revolution, body politic. Even if we are ready to forgive everything, what is the point to which this bourgeois liberal movement has now come, and how far may it still get? Has it even attained its own bourgeois liberal goal? Or after all, facts are now on the table and should be clear to everyone. How far, I ask, has the Bourgeois liberal movement gotten in the 15 years that have passed since 1848, and where does it stand at present? As a matter of fact, it has simply moved from compromise to compromise, from concession to concession, from conciliation to conciliation, until it has reached the point that we in Prussia are not yet in possession of the achievements that the small constitutional provinces attained in the 20s of the century. We have not even the right to grant the budget, not even the foundation of any constitutional state. We are actually living under a pure absolutism. Thus, the liberal bourgeoisie has lost one after another all the achievements which the democracy had won for us in 1848. With the shedding of its blood, these have been lost to such an extent at 52 Lassalle 53. The liberal bourgeoisie has now given up even the last right, and one which meant a good deal to the bourgeoisie itself, namely the right of granting the budget. And even under these circumstances, the Progressive Party, which has a great majority in the Prussian Diet, was unable to make up its mind to declare an open and outright break with the government. It simply continues to bicker and conciliate. Instead of cutting the cloth clean between it and the government, as was its bounden duty, it continues to sit at the same table with the government, which it has itself declared to be guilty of a breach of the penal code. While in its speeches it declares itself that the government has overthrown the constitution, it continues in session filing amendment on amendment, and thus helps the government maintain an appearance of respectability, as if a constitutional condition still prevailed. The Progressive Party, owing to its weakness, has become the accomplice of the government. The measure of our patience cannot therefore be exhausted. Why have I not raised my voice before? Gentlemen, after all, I and the outright Democrats in general have never had any doubt that the movement inspired by the liberal bourgeoisie in place of the democratic movement will ultimately come to the sad end. We have long been aware of this condition in advance, but we felt it our duty to 54 speeches of wait until the facts should be on the table, facts which could have an influence on the general opinion. Today this condition has been reached. He who will not see today must be blind or determined not to see. It would therefore be quite silly today to accuse me of any desire to abolish our unity, or even if unity should be the highest good. Why then, we might just as well, all of us, we as well as the Progressive Party, seek a union with the absolutist and military parties and mutually embrace each other. The question at issue is, what is to be the basis of our unity? A unity in weakness, in worthlessness, in exhaustion. Such a unity is of no avail. It is far better to challenge all the vigorous elements and rally them to a great and powerful stand. 2 months ago I was still rebuked with the fact that even the entire liberal press in England recognizes our Progressive Party. No doubt this still was the case 2 months ago. But will you read the articles which have since appeared in the London Times, in the Daily News, etc., articles which are no longer directed against our government, but against our Diet, and which declare unmistakably that a Diet which would accept it nuil me is nay, fiat unisoft itunda is one. I am quoting literally, abasement of the people. In what way therefore have I been guilty, gentle Lassalle 55 man? Only in my quality as a statesman, i.e. in my ability to foresee a few months earlier what would be admitted openly a few months later by all persons of impartial mind. If I am now questioned therefore, why don't you wait until the bourgeoisie has finished its struggle with the military state? I can truthfully answer you, I have not been waiting for this moment, for the simple reason that this moment will never come. The libera bourgeoisie can never fight this battle to a victorious outcome. The sole means for attaining political freedom is precisely this movement, however, which I have originated, and I shall now prove this to you by reasons which will be more and more convincing as I proceed, and for which I ask your fulest attention. Our liberal bourgeoisie, I am telling you, cannot break the military state, cannot achieve political freedom in its struggle. First, and as yet the weakest reason for this condition, is the fact that it has passed out of existence as a class, and even before it has attained full growth, a stature of completeness is productive of strength. The unfinished state has no strength at all. But this is the feeblest reason. I shall first call your attention to certain facts. Has the bourgeoisie in our country ever developed the energy shown by the bourgeoisie of France in 1789 and in 183? Has it ever succeeded in calling forth energetic action anywhere? Never. When 56 speeches of Louis XVI wished to dissolve the Constituent Assembly in France, the bourgeoisie answered unanimously through the lips of Mirabeau, "We shall yield only to the force of bayonets." And now in the city of Frankfurt, a Constituent Assembly was also in session in the year 1849, and when the King of Prussia recalled the delegates, a great majority went home as quickly as they could, and only a small minority offered resistance and proceeded to Stuttgart. The ultima ratio regum, the last resort of kings, is a cannon, as has been said before. But our bourgeoisie will never come what may resort to the energy of such a decision. It is prevented from doing so not only by its fear of governments, but also by its fear of the people. Today the bourgeoisie is still hoodwinking you, but it knows very well it will lose this influence in the heat of certain outbursts, and it still fears you very much more than it fears absolutism. It is for this reason that the bourgeoisie humbles itself again and again before the steps that lead to the throne, even though it encounter a veritable shower of kicks from above, and continues to whine its declarations that it does not yet give up. Oh, lest I be accused of describing my opponents in my own words, of setting up a man of straw, therefore permit me to present them to you in their own words, to quote as evidence. For example, a passage from a speech delivered by Scholz Telitz on Lassalle 57 November 30th of last year. In other words, after the present cabinet had already assumed office, in other words, under the present condition of an overthrown constitution, this speech was delivered at Frankfurt in the Main, and I am quoting from one of the newspapers of his supporters, a Vossische Zeitung, after pointing out that it is the Prussian government which will be crawled upon after all by its position of power in Germany, carry out the history. historical task of the unification of the country. Schulz-Delitzsch goes on in the following strain: a period of absolutism which would guide the destinies of peoples according to its own whim and its own arbitrary caprice is now past, and the Prussian dynasty, so often blessed with God's favors, will someday find a champion who will be able to grasp the purified principle of monarchism in a correct spirit and to apply this understanding to the great good of his own country and of Germany as a whole. Courage and perseverance among the people will produce such a champion in the Prussian dynasty, even if he is not yet discernible. The people express their true political maturity by the very fact that they abominate the path of revolution as contrasted with other nations and assume instead the peaceable and civilized path of agitation. General, these words were spoken. Gentlemen, after B. Diet had been denied the right to grant the budget and the military organization bill had been put 58 plus al through arbitrarily in defiance of the Diet, were pronounced at a time when the situation of things was not different in principle from that of today. Who is therefore, gentlemen, who would hand you per to the reaction, who would deliver you to the tender mercies of Prussian absolutism? And it is under this banner that you are to march, and it is under this banner that you think you will be able to put down so serious and real a power as that of absolutism and the military state. It is because they are afraid of you that they pin their hopes to the powers above, and with this fear of what is below, and with this hope I ram those that are above. You think it is possible to achieve anything? Do not forget the words of Goethe: was ist der Philister ein Holder darm Walfurcht TMD Hoffnung das Gott Erbarmel. When such a Philistine movement can never achieve any results, even though we should travel through centuries, or if we should be obliged to live through entire geological periods, from arbitrarily, one Philistine is merely an inflated bladder full of fears and hopes. God have mercy on him, my Spartacus, or Saturnalia, my friends. For 14 long years we had permitted the Liberal Party to go on practicing an unheard of self-denial. We had avoided everything, every initiative of our own, every demand of our own that might have deprived this party of the appearance of being the party that controlled the masses of the people. But now it must be clear to all the world that these 14 years of unsuccessful waiting would necessarily be followed by 1400 years of equally hopeless waiting. If we should go on letting this party have its way and pretending to be the people one, it was now clear, at least to every thinking man, that these weaklings would never be able to cut a path for freedom. No consideration could no longer deter us. We now no longer even had a choice. A moment had come for us to come out and establish ourselves as that which we really always had been, an independent, separate party. Indeed, this had now become our bounden duty. We could no longer tolerate the appearance of belonging to a party which had descended to this abyss of shameful weakness. It was necessary for us to save our honor, to save the honor of the country. 5960 speeches of for me, this motive was so imperative that even if I had had to stand alone in my protest, I should nevertheless have always looked back upon it with pride and satisfaction. But I was not obliged to stand alone. It appeared once more that when one man has the courage to proclaim his principles, the echo from the breast of the people will answer him a thousandfold. Thousands and thousands have joined me in this protest. Our organization itself is the result. In this alone we should have performed a great act. When later historians set down the sad history of these days, they will say, at least there were men who came out in righteous wrath against the shame. Our act has prevented these historians from saying, and there was not one man in GER many who protested against such a disgrace. The events that have come to pass since then have necessarily placed the limitless weakness of the Progressive Party in even a brighter illumination than before. I shall first remind you of the Rhenish Congress of Delegates at Cologne, and Roland said, these were the Saturnalia of the German bourgeoisie. You should have been there to see, not only in Cologne, but wherever the eye might look in Germany, wherever your glance encountered the news items of German newspapers, very where you could read, see, and hear of festivals, preparations for festivals, portraits of delegates to festivals, etc. Can you imagine it? What were these remarkless al 61 able persons celebrating while the situation of the country was such that one should go about in sackcloth and ashes? Here holding festivals, one festivals of the type inaugurated by the French after a victorious revolution are celebrated in Germany after defeats. In order to escape the real struggle, they get up a dinner at which the vanquished sing hymns of victory behind their wine glasses and roasts. In fact, this topsy-turvy state very closely resembles that of the Roman Saturnalia in Rome. The slaves seated themselves at table and acted as if they were the masters. So today, vanquished sit down to a banquet and carry on as if they were the victors in their pompous and tasteless toasts of victory. And just as the Roman slaves proved by accepting the Saturnalia that they were willingly subjecting themselves to a whole year of slavery in exchange for this illusory freedom of one day, so our progressives make clear to every man of understanding by their illusory celebrations of victory that they are willing to dispense with the real struggle and the real victory. Hence, Spartacus and his men raised the banner of the slave insurrection in Rome in order to make free men of slaves. He was doing more than engaging incidentally in festivities. The secret of the strength of our government has thus far been rooted in the rigid weakness of its adversaries. Reaction will always have an easy 62 speeches of time in carrying off the victory if it deals, of course, with such opponents. Nothing has been proved but the total incapacity of the progressives for any political struggle. A party which cannot cover its most important position with its own corpses in order to defend it, such a party bears no promise of victory within. Such a party knows no other course than to run away again at every new attack. Such a party, such a press, do not even deserve an expression of regret when the lash of the government resounds on their backs. He who has no ability at all to defend his high has no right to existence, does not deserve to live on. What interest can we have in men who run away at every attack, and champions who face each new blow not with their fists but with their backsides? What other feelings may be aroused in us by such a spectacle than those of contempt and ridicule, of disgust, of scorn at such heroes? In fact, higher and purer become the goals pursued by such men, greater must be our contempt to find that not even such high goals can produce a more manly attitude in their bearers. And the sole slightly extenuating circumstances that may be found for the actions of the progressives is actually precisely in the fact that in the last analysis their purposes really concern themselves only with affording somewhat more influence to a handful of persons. Such lamentably Lassalle 63 contemptible purposes can produce only a lamentably contemptible bearing. Only a great idea, only enthusiasm for great goals can beget devotion, self-sacrifice, audacity. L from Diffus, I press end to Frankfurter am Jordan Tenta, a class struggle. But now I shall indicate the last and true reason why the liberal bourgeoisie cannot bring about political freedom in our country. After we have lost since 1848, without after position after position, ensure everything we gained in that year, you will understand that such a period of 15 years of history cannot have been an accident. Such a period must have an internal motive of which it is the necessary result. I shall now reveal this cause to you. You will see that this cause will explain all of German history since 1848 and all of French history since 1789. You will see that the reason for the lack of energy on the part of our liberal bourgeoisie as compared with that of France is based not merely on the national character, but goes back far deeper, and that the sole path for an attainment of political freedom is that of rallying about the banner I am now defending. This reason is the following: a merely political freedom can now no longer be successfully achieved because no material interest, because no class interest, and therefore no class stands behind this demand. 64 Lassalle 65. No doubt the liberal bourgeoisie loves liberty, but it loves liberty as one loves an ornament in one's apartment, as one loves an article of jewelry. If one cannot afford it, one does without. One will face neither drowning nor burning for such an acquisition. The main point for the bourgeoisie remains its material interests, its trade, and its habits, its industry and production. But all these require peace, and serious struggles for liberty would merely endanger this peace for the moment. Therefore, a liberal bourgeoisie would much rather dispense with political freedom than jeopardize the public peace and thereby its material interests by resorting to a serious struggle for freedom. Therefore, which class stands behind the demand for political freedom? The worker, perhaps, yes, for a few weeks or even a few months, by reason of his brave and noble hearty, and therefore he will again and again fight temporary battles for it and carry off its temporary victories, as he did in March 1848. But in the long run, the worker also will not be content with mere political liberty. That is impossible. He cares for his daily wages, for the existence of his family and himself, take up too much of his attention. He cannot satisfy his hunger on mere political liberty, and so he will necessarily relinquish the struggle and in the long run let things proceed as they always have done. Just cast a glance on France, and a statement of 66 speeches of mine will make clear to you what appear to be the greatest contradictions in the history of France. A revolution of 1789, as well as the Napoleonic coup d'etat of R851. A revolution of 1789 was by no means only a political revolution. It would be a grave error to assume this. It was a social revolution, a revolution with material interests at stake. The task of the bourgeoisie was to break feudal production in industry and agriculture and to replace it with a free exploitation of capital such as we find in power everywhere today. For these goals it developed energy and fire. It was a social revolution, and such were the social and material interests at stake in 1789 as well as later in 1830. But under the Napoleon who now rules, and of who of course it was not seriously to be feared that he would again restore the feudal conditions of production that he would violate the material interests of the bourgeoisie. In other words, when the point now turned out to be that of defending a merely political liberty against him, French bourgeoisie was as weak and tired as ours and calmly permitted itself to be robbed of its political liberty, a process that has now been going on for 12 years. If the subject of contention in our country today were the social liberties of the bourgeoisie that were at stake in I-78Q in France, the liberty of capital, Lassalle 67, and all those material interests involved in this liberty, our bourgeoisie might perhaps have displayed the same energy that was shown by the French bourgeoisie. But these material questions are no longer under discussion. Our governments have prepared themselves in advance. In part, at least, they introduced the social phase of the revolution of 1789 long ago, and a merely political liberty will not arouse the enthusiasm of the bourgeoisie and do no more than inspire them to pious expressions and innocent rhetorical exercises. I think you will agree that I have shown that no class stands or can stand behind the demand of a merely political liberty. But this demand is opposed by the military parties and the nobility, the absolutism, and the bureaucracy, and indeed with the greatest energy, in fact, with all the energy that can be released by social interests, for these classes are concerned with the maintenance of the remnants of their power. Reaction is bad, therefore, by classes with the greatest energy, by classes which will use their nails and teeth. Political freedom is backed by no class as the support of only a handful of ideologists and sentimental enthusiasts. And it surprise you, therefore, that political freedom has been suffering defeats at the hands of the reaction for the past 15 years. And it surprise you, under these circumstances, that the bourgeoisie is powerless and will never be able 68 speeches of to fight out its struggle with the military state to the achievement of victory. The most important thing to be done for political freedom is to back it with a class interest, a social interest, and of course, if possible, the interest of the impoverished classes, whose numbers and energy are so infinitely superior to those of other classes. Anyone who loves political freedom owes me a deed of gratitude for this statement, or even a purely political freedom can secure victory only under this emblem. No doubt you now feel, gentlemen, how false it was to accuse me of standing in the service of reaction, and I say not only how false it was, in fact, it would be far beneath me to begin with an attempt to defend my character. I say therefore that this accusation was not only untrue, but that the untruth of it was perfectly apparent to those who raised it against me. I say that they consciously and shamefully distorted the facts. The liberal bourgeoisie does not fear that I am tainted with reaction, as it maintains, but it fears, on the contrary, that the educational work I am carrying on may, in the course of a few years, develop the most serious opposition to the reaction. Give me German workers who will join my organization, and our reaction is a thing of the past. Our bourgeoisie knows this. This is what they fear from me. Therefore, they have attacked me, Lassalle 69, with this blind rage. And while they fear that I am seriously demanding political freedom, they accuse me of standing in the service of reaction. A split between us and the Progressive Party can no longer be avoided. It is a split that resembles the cleaning of the chaff from the wheel. Split is reality. This is no longer a time for diplomacy or for considerations of expediency. Every man among them must now ask himself and his conscience whether he belongs to the wheat or to the chaff. From Arbiter Lisbon, Lassalle reactionaire, have you not heard the Volkszeitung and the Berliner Reform recently disseminate with more energy than ever the rumor that I am in the service of the reaction? And can you not understand by merely reading this wretched and awkward fabrication how monstrous is the deception that is being practiced against you? I shall reveal to you the reason for this deception. Workers of Berlin, progressive bourgeoisie, hate me and pick quarrels with me, not because they fear that I am tainted with the principles of reaction, but on the contrary, because they fear that revolution will come from me, not because I am reactionary in their eyes, but because I am revolutionary in their eyes. I ask for the truth of the latter accusation. I have in the truthfulness of my soul admitted it 100 times whenever it was raised against me. I have admitted it in public gatherings, in my works, in my speeches. In fact, time and time again, I have admitted it before the courts. Once more, and why do the progressives not declare, as would be demanded by the truth, that they hate me and combat me as a revolutionary because of the nature of their constitution? Why on 70 Lassalle 71, the contrary, do they constantly circulate among you the calumnious remark that I am in the service of the reaction? The reason is very plain. It is as plain as it is base and outrageous. The progressives cannot accuse me of being a revolutionary in your presence. In your presence, as they well know, this accusation, which constitutes the true basis of their rage against me, would merely have the result of attaching the more firmly whole masses of you, and therefore these hypocrites turn their spear the other way and accuse me in your presence of serving the reaction because they hate me as a revolutionary. Workers, you who are men whose yes means yes and whose no means no, what are you going to do with weathercocks of this improved type? What shall you do with men who are in favor of the Reform Act when they are in Frankfurt among the Pan-Germans, and who are opposed to the Reform Act when they are in Berlin among the Prussians? What shall you do with tightrope dancers who affect the black and yellow colors in August and the black and white in October? What shall you do with men who are worse than weathercocks since they change their direction even without encountering a blast? And yet the situation of the German question has suffered no change on the part of the German princes since last August. 72 speeches of have not inaugurated the slightest new step that might be taken as a semblance of an excuse for this change of tack. What shall you do with men who, in the most important national question, do not even know what they themselves want, and who therefore are all the less capable of telling you what you shall want? What use can you have for men who cannot even follow up a principle when it concerns our entire existence as a nation? What can you do with political children? Well, like children love to imitate the great, with men who confuse a people's policy with princes' diplomacy, who aim at diplomatic acuteness, and as a result, as is natural, are obliged to admit in October downright stupidity of what they considered remarkably clever in August, still incurring the risk, however, of finding that in some other matter their astuteness in October was by no means superior to their folly in August. How could you hope, workers, that you would ever be able to achieve the great interests of liberty in cooperation with such men of petty spirit, or to overcome the obstacles which can yield only to a supreme consistency of principle? Why, therefore, should prevent you from joining out ranks? And are you, workers of Berlin, not obliged to take the step by the additional reason of our social Lassalle 73 program, the improvement of your social situation? Which one of you / one workers would be so narrow-minded and so blind to his own interests as not to recognize the profound injustice of your class situation and the necessity of improving Ermann die Arbeiter Berlin's of the workers of Berlin? A speech delivered in the name of the Allgemeine Deutscher Arbeiterverein on October 14, 1860, BLACK1 red and gold or black, white and red. You know that the members of the National Union and of the Progressive Party who constitute the Congress of Deputies 7 had always declared their adherence to the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution of 1849, which they announced was the legal basis 7 the palladium of the German nation. I must at the outset seek to clear away any misunderstanding. Revision to the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution is not my point of view 7, nor is it our point of view. In our eyes, the attempt to re-establish the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution is nothing more or less than a reactionary utopia. From our point of view, the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution was already one when it was adopted in 1849, nothing else than a final evidence of the impotence of federalism. German UNITY 7, a unified sovereign central power accompanied by a retention of the 34 different separate sovereignties, is in itself a contradiction. Is as impossible as it is for a white coat to be black. Sovereignty 7, whether it inhere in the princes or in the people, 7 is indivisible. 774 Lassalle 75, by its very nature, as indivisible as the soul of man. What we really need, therefore, if we are to speak of German unity, is the cessation of these 34 independent separate sovereignties and their combination into one sovereignty. And this is the reason why the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution was unable to maintain itself for a single day. 20 pieces, not as our progressives believe, by reason of its revolutionary character, which we are told was too advanced for the time, but by reason of its reactionary character, it went to pieces not because of the changes it made, but because it retained too much of the old. It was a sacrifice to the above mentioned logical contradiction involved in the existence of a unified central power having 34 sovereignties. For us, therefore, the idea of again establishing the Frankfurt Imperial Constitution can be nothing else than a reactionary utopia. It is a utopia, a pious wish, for the reason that this constitution, because of its internal contradiction, will be for us as unable to keep alive for a single day in the future as it has been in the past. It is reactionary because if we should again be obliged to begin with our unsuccessful experiment of 1849, this would mean that our entire history since 1848 has had no significance and no moral for us at all, in our opinion, which is to the effect that the destruction of the Frankfurt 76 speeches of imperial constitution was merely the necessary consequence of its internal contradiction and the final evidence of the impotence of federalism. In our opinion, this period of 14 years of history would have a meaning and a great meaning, even though it had been purchased dearly. On the other hand, Herr von Bismarck rebukes the progressives for having betrayed Prussia, and on the other hand, Pan-German organs maintain that the Progressive Party is betraying Germany to the party's secret passion of keeping Prussia at the head. And the most remarkable point, gentlemen is that both Herr von Bismarck and the Pen-Germans are right where the progressives have achieved the apparently impossible task in their attempt to make themselves beloved on all sides of betraying everything they have advocated and denied everything in the same breath. In our eyes, therefore, a Prussian constitution which was only an evidence and a product of a legal violation committed against the people is without value or interest as it is without a legal existence. For us, the struggle of the two parties has no essential interest, for both parties, reactionaries as well as the progressives, are equally strangers to us. There is no interest of principle for us in this struggle, since the entire object of contention, the Prussian constitution, has no interest for us. On Lassalle 17, the contrary, the Prussian constitution can arouse no other interest in us than the desire to have it disappear as quickly as possible. I know from Die Fassi Press, Frankfurter Abgeordnete Tenta, the sunrise of the future, the thing that was unable to maintain itself in France, the thing that at that time really went to pieces, was not the Republic as such, but the Republic that abolished the universal suffrage by the election law of May 30 XASO and set up a disguised property qualification in order to exclude the workers. In other words, it was the bourgeois republic which wished to impress even upon the Republican state the image of the bourgeoisie domination of capital. It was this which afforded the French usurper an opportunity to overthrow the Republic under the pretext of establishing the universal suffrage. And yet this Republic under other circumstances would have found an insurmountable bulwark in the breast of the French workers, a thing therefore which was then really not able to maintain itself in France and was therefore overthrown, was not the Republic as such, but the bourgeois republic. And therefore an honest study of the situation will show precisely by means of this example that the period of history in which we have lived since February 848 will no longer tolerate a state which either in monarchic or Republican 78 Lassalle 79 form aims to maintain the dominant political imprint of the third bourgeois state of society. From the high watchtowers of science, gentlemen, one can discern the red dawn of the new day sooner than if one is situated in the turmoil of daily life. Gentlemen, have you ever witnessed a sunrise from a high mountaintop? Purple border tinges the extreme horizon with a red and bloody glow that announces the new light. Mist and fogs rise and contract into great mountains attacking the rosy dawn and for the moment concealing its rays, but no underscore power on earth is capable of hindering the slow and majestic ascent of the sun itself, which but a single hour later will stand shining bright and warm in the sky visible to all the world. And this single hour in such a great spectacle of nature which is repeated every day is equivalent to one or two decades in the far more imposing spectacle of a sunrise in history. From our beer program, right to revolution, the duty of the workers, we are all workers insofar as we have the will to make ourselves useful to human society in some way or other. This fourth estate, which therefore contains in its heart chambers not a germ of any new privileges, for this very reason synonymous with the entire human race. Its cause is therefore a cause of humanity as a whole. Its freedom is the freedom of humanity as a whole. Its rule is the rule of all. Anyone who appeals therefore the idea of the working class as the dominant principle of society in the sense in which I have just expounded this to you will not utter a cry that will divide and separate the classes of society. He will rather utter a cry of conciliation, a cry that will embrace all of society, a cry for the abolition of all the contrasts in the social strata, a cry for union in which all should join who are opposed to privileges and to suppression of the people by privileged classes, a cry of law which once it has forced its way from the heart of the people will forever be the true slogan of the people, and which for the sake of its content, Sola Sal 81 alone, will remain nonetheless a cry of love even when it resounds as the people's battle cry. To be sure, lower classes still retain more selfishness than they should. But this selfishness, sir, it is present in this case, is the defect of individuals, of certain persons, and not an essential defect of the class. Even a modicum of instinct will inform the members of the lower classes that insofar as every one of them thinks only of himself and acts only for himself, he can never hope for any essential improvement of his situation. But insofar as the lower classes of society aim at an improvement of their situation as a class, an improvement of their lot as a class, to precisely this extent will this personal interest, instead of opposing itself to the historical tendency and thus being condemned as a socially immoral act, will it coincide in direction with the development of the entire people, with the victory of the idea, with the advances of civilization, with the life principle of history itself, which is nothing more or less than the growth of freedom, or as we have already seen above, your cause is the cause of humanity as a whole. You are therefore in the fortunate situation, gentlemen, of being not dead to new ideas, but rather owing to your own personal interest, extremely susceptible to them. You are in the fortunate situation in which that which constitutes your 82 speeches of true personal best interest actually coincides with the beating pulses of history, with the driving life force of moral evolution. You may therefore attach yourself with personal, with passionate feeling to the evolution of history, and be assured that your position will be the more impregnable, as this passion, in the pure sense in which we have thus depicted it, is the more ardent and consuming. These are the reasons, gentlemen, why the rule of the fourth estate must bring to the nation an efflorescence of morality, of civilization, and science such as has never before been seen in history. The moral idea of the bourgeoisie holds that the individual is to be guaranteed nothing more than an exclusive right to the self-activity of his forces. If we were all equally strong, equally intelligent, equally educated, and equally wealthy, this idea might be considered as a sufficient and moral idea. But as we do not and cannot enjoy such equality, this thought is insufficient, and in its consequences, therefore, necessarily leads to a profound immorality, or at least to an exploitation of the weaker by the stronger. The more intelligent, the more wealthy, the stronger will put the weaker in his pocket. The moral idea of the working class, on the other hand, holds that the free and untrammeled activity of the powers of the individual by himself is of itself not sufficient, but that there must be added in morally well-ordered community a solidarity of Lassalle 83 interests and a common possession, a common mutuality of evolution. In accordance with this difference, the bourgeoisie conceives the moral purpose of the state as consisting only in the duty to protect the personal liberty of the individual and his property. This is a policeman's idea, gentlemen, a policeman's idea, for the reason that it creates the state after the image of the policeman, whose sole function consists or should consist in preventing theft and burglary. I am sorry to say that this policeman notion is not only peculiar to the liberals, but also to many alleged Democrats, owing to their insufficient mental training. If the bourgeoisie should consistently pronounce its last word, it would be obliged to admit that, according to these ideas of its own, there would be no reason for a state at all if it were not for the existence of robbers and thieves. A state, therefore, which is placed under the dominion of the idea of the working class, would no longer, as has been the case with all the states thus far, be driven about willingly by the course of events and the compulsion of circumstances, but would elevate this moral character of the state into its chief task with extreme clarity and in full consciousness. It would achieve with free vigor and complete consistency things that have thus far been achieved only piecemeal and in the faintest outline, in opposition to reluctant concessions. And by this 84 Lassalle very means, it would thus necessarily bring about an elevation of the spirit, of production of a sum total of happiness, culture, well-being, and liberty that have had no parallel in the world's history, and as compared to which even the most highly lauded periods of earlier days will become mere shadow. For all those who are members of the working class, what I have just said should be a reminder of their duty to assume an entirely new attitude. Nothing is better suited to impart to a certain class a dignified, profoundly moral character in the consciousness that this class is destined to be the ruling class, that it is called upon to elevate the principle of its class as the principle of the generation in which it lives, to make its idea the dominant idea of the entire society, and in turn reconstruct society in its own name. A high world historic privilege of having such a destiny must inspire all your idea. It is no longer appropriate for you to retain the vices of the oppressed, or the idle distractions of the thoughtless, or even the harmless carelessness of the insignificant. You are the rock on which the church of the future shall be built. T from our beer program to the Supreme Court. In the first part of my speech, in my consideration of the Middle Ages, I had mentioned that the abolition of the guilds had been demanded as early as 1672 in the German Diet, and as early as R6-R4 in the French Etats Generaux. I had mentioned that in the year R776 the reform minister Turgot abolished guilds in France, but that the king was forced by the outcries of the privileged classes to recall his own edict a few months later, and that they finally won by the storming of the Bastille. A single day's work achieved results that had been worked for in vain in Germany and France for almost two centuries. To this statement I had added the following objective historical observation. You will see therefore, gentlemen, that no matter how great are the advantages inherent in reforms by the legal method, this method nevertheless suffers in all important matters from the disadvantage of sometimes remaining powerless for centuries, and on the other hand, that the path of revolution, however undeniable its defects may be, has the advantage of leading swiftly and energetically to a practical outcome. And in this strictly objective and historical observation, which expounds impartially both the 586 speeches of advantages and disadvantages of revolutions, and which was taken from a historical presentation of the Middle Ages, the first judge finds a reason for passing sentence of condemnation, since he assumes that I necessarily prefer the revolutionary course to the legal course, and that I in consequence would necessarily be of the same opinion with regard to the present epoch of history and the goals to be achieved in it, and will therefore be inspired in the bottom of my heart with the idea that the working classes should act similarly. Now I could hardly believe my eyes when I encountered in the sentence this basis of the condemnation, aside from the fact that even if one should admit this logical process, it would lead only to an indictment for inciting to revolution against the state power and not to an indictment for inciting to hatred and contempt for citizens of the state. Does not the first judge understand that this condemnation on the basis of inferences is a most flagrant transgression of all the principles of justice? These inferences are entirely erroneous and deceive. They are paralogisms whose incorrectness I have proven to you with as much brevity as clearness in the document serving as a justification for my appeal. But even if these conclusions should be as correct as they really are incorrect, does not the first Lassalle 81 judge understand that he has no right to indulge in such inferences? Does he not know that it is his duty to adhere to my stated words only and not to venture any intrusion into the sacred domain of my internal freedom of thought? That he has not the slightest right to drag before the tribunal of penal justice views that have not been expressed, even though it might be possible to infer from what has been expressed that such thoughts might be present at the bottom of my soul? I was boundlessly astonished at this, for the judgment here involves a violation of all the most sacred principles of justice, a violation that is so flagrant that it remains without precedent on this scale, even in periods of an utter contempt for justice. So you know, gentlemen, which case has been chosen by conservative writers of history as the worst atrocity against justice of which the tribunals of the terror were guilty under the French Revolution. It is the case of a condemnation which was pronounced on an accused person who had been found guilty of singing the song Zero Richard Monday Royal Zero Richard Mike. Well, I am being sentenced because the judge believes he has heard, not from my lips, no, but in the deepest recesses of my soul, a melody Zero Revolution Mare Zero Revolution My Queen. I shall not conceal from you, gentlemen, that our 88 speeches of views may be widely different. Certainly I wish for many things which you do not wish, and I am opposed to many things that you wish, but what has this to do with the sphere of justice? /BE are even more widely divergent in the matter of what we believe than in the matter of what we wish. You do not believe in the possibility of a revolution, gentlemen, and yet my studies have brought me to the point in which I believe in the possibility of a revolution. In my speech of defense before the court of the first instance, I already made statements as to the scientific meaning of the word revolution, the meaning in which I understand this word. The definition I assign to this word is simply that of substituting a new principle for an old condition, either with or without the use of force. In this sense, I can say that I am at any rate convinced of the future occurrence of a revolution. It will either come with full legality and with all the blessings of peace, if men are wise enough to make up their minds in time to enable them to introduce it from above, or it will come within some appreciable period as a whirlwind with all the convulsions of violence, as a fury with wild waving hair, with bronze sandals on her feet. In either one of these two ways, revolution will Lassalle 89 come, of that there is no doubt. And when I cut myself off from the tumult of the day and bury myself in the study of history, I can hear her treading her iron gate from die indirect stoirland dilage to arbitendon class e indirect taxation and the situation of the working class. A speech delivered by Lassalle in his own defense before the Royal Chamber Court in answer to the accusation of having publicly incited the propertyless classes to ultra and contempt for the prosperous and explanatory notes Allgemeiner Deutscher Arbeiterverein General German / Marcus Union, an organization founded by Ferdinand Lassalle in 1863. Bastille, a prison fortress built at the Port Saint Antoine Harris in 1369, destroyed by a popular uprising July 14, 1789. It was regarded as a symbol of anarchical despotism, and July 14, the day of its demolition, remains a national holiday in France. Ismar Hans Otto von 1815-1898, German statesman, founder of the German Empire, famous for his exception laws directed against the socialist movement in Germany. Red and gold colors proposed for the national German flag by the Frankfurt Assembly of 1848, symbolically therefore a liberal or progressive attitude in politics. Black, white, and red, the colors of the German National Ensign since 1871, symbolically therefore an imperialistic and nationalistic attitude. Chamber, this word is used by Lassalle to designate the lower house of the Prussian legislature. The Communist Manifesto, the first popular declaration of the principles and program of scientific socialism, written by Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels and printed in 1847. Constituent Assembly, also called National Assembly or Convention, the first of the revolutionary legislative bodies of France, 1789-1791, alleged not to separate until the constitution was established. Engels, Friedrich, 1820-1895, for a study of his life and work. C.T. Riazano, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, 1927, Etats Generaux, see States G.E.R. Erich, Johann Gottlieb, 1762-1814, German philosopher. See Franz Mehring, Social Forces in German History, 1927, Fortschrittspartei, Progressive Party, also called Fortschrittsmänner, Men of Progress, a liberal party founded in Prussia in 1861 and predominant in the Prussian Diet until 1866, when the National Liberal Party was formed from it. 91-92, EXP Electory Notes, fourth estate of persons constituting the lowest and unrepresented classes of society, as distinguished from the commons, we should now call it the proletariat. Frankfurt Parliament, H.I. Colonati, the first predecessor of the modern German Reichstag, assembled in St. Paul's Church, Frankfurt, May 18, 1848, May 31, 1849. Its constitutional reforms were not finally adopted until 1864. Asfeld, Sophie Antis, 1805 to 1881, married Count Hot Oxfeld in 1822, divorced in 1851. Lassalle's friendship for her was the cause of his devoting to her service many years, which might otherwise have come to the revolutionary movement. Alkmaar Erhard, born 1862, living German dramatist, the author of a number of social dramas in prose and verse, including the prose drama Die Weber Weavers, 1892. Hegel, George Wilhelm Friedrich, 1770 to 1831, German philosopher. His philosophy is characterized by the so-called Hegelian dialectic, or principle which enables reflective thinking to arrange all the categories or necessary conceptions of reason in an order of development that corresponds to the actual order and development of all reality. Heine, 1797-1856, German lyricist, also the most fluent prose writer of Germany. While not a member of any revolutionary movement, Heine was impelled by his ardent hatred of tyranny to favor many indications of political discontent. Helmut Willy, living Bavarian statesman, born 1877, one of the founders of the German Democratic Party in 1918. Jacobi Johann, 1805-1877, German Democratic leader. He participated in the revolution of 1848 in Germany, imprisoned many times. A few years before his death, he joined the socialist movement. Junker, a German word from the Middle High German, Junher, youngster, a member of the landed gentry, a country gentleman of the nobility, the German equivalent to the landed nobility of England. Lessing, Gotthold Ephraim, 1728-1781, German critic, dramatist, and philosopher, author of Nathan Erwise, Emilia Galotti, Minna von Barnhelm, etc. Machiavellian art of government. Niccolo Machiavelli was a Florentine statesman and writer whose chief work, One Litter Principe, the Prince, contains advice to rulers on the proper manner of mystifying and governing a people. Explanatory notes. 93. Manchufel, Otto von, 1805-1882, Prussian reactionary statesman who dispersed the National Assembly in Berlin, November 1849. Marx, Karl, 1818-1883, for a study of his life and work. C.P. Riazano, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, 1927. Mary Rons, 1846-1919, German revolutionary socialist, publicist, and historian, author of Social Forces in German History, 1927, and of a history of the German social democracy and the life of Karl Marx in German. Emily River, formerly marking the eastern boundary of Germany up to 1919, its mouth, which empties into the Baltic Sea, is now in Lithuania. Mirabeau Onta, 1749-1791, French statesman and orator, a member of the Constituent Assembly. Moselle, G.E.R. Moselle River in eastern France and western Germany, joining the Rhine at Koblenz. Napoleon Louis, 1808-1873, nephew of Napoleon Bonaparte, resident of the Second French Republic, later Emperor of France until 1871. Napoleonic coup d'état of XSSX, or a thorough account. See Karl Marx, the 18th premier of Louis Bonaparte, 1926. National Assembly. Several national assemblies were held in Germany in 1848 and 1849 to determine the political and social conditions under which the unification of the empire should take place. All these bodies deliberated without result. However, National Verein, a political organization formed in 1859, ostensibly with the purpose of securing the unification and the free development of Germany, but later imbued with reactionary spirit. Paralogism, a fallacy in reason in which the reasoner is unconscious, also loosely any act of false reason. Progressive Party, Fortschrittspartei, Realpolitik, a German compound noun, a statesman who is proud that though he may be governed by ideals in far, he nevertheless faces the real situation as it is. A realist in politics. Renis Xidu, an organ of the Rhenish radical bourgeoisie, edited from October 1842 January 1843 by Karl Marx. 94 Explanatory Notes. Robert Tuzar, 1805 to 1875, German economic writer, author of Das Kapital with the same title as Karl Marx's great work, Die Bucharan, the economic theory of the leisure class. 1927 Roland Say, a village and watering place on the left bank of the Rhine. Schulstelitz, German, 1808 to 1883, reactionary German statesman and economist. See Franz Mary, social forces in German history. 1927 Schweitzer, ABI, 1833 to 1875, German socialist publicist, editor of the periodical Der Sozialdemokrat, beginning January 1, 1865. Warren Patokavin, a liberal Prussian ministry, one of the members of which was Count Maximilian Schwerin. 1804-1872 Characteristically enough, Schwerin was one of the first liberals to vote for the policy of the Bismarck cabinet in 1866. States General, a general as opposed to provincial legislature, imposed of different see or estates of citizens, the name of the legislative body of the Netherlands and that of France during the revolution. It was invoked in France only in periods of national crisis. Service state common comm unitas immunitas, as distinguished from the nobles and the clergy. Reclass election law, an election system in which the suffrage right was divided into three classes in accordance with the amount of taxes paid by the voter. This system was introduced in Prussia in 1849 and remained in force with extensive alterations dating from 1893 until the revolution of November 9, 1918. And Robert Jaw, 1727 to 1781, general supervisor of finances in France before the revolution. Old Society, a political daily of democratic tendency which began appearing in Berlin in April 1853. Voss Society, a liberal daily, the oldest still published at Berlin, founded in 1725. It is named after one of its early publishers, Christian Friedrich Voss. Its policy is liberal. Voices of Revolt, a series of small books in which are collected the outstanding utterances of world famous leaders in revolutionary thought and action. Each volume contains a special introduction. 1 to Emma Borg, 50 cents. I, Maximilian Robespierre, 2. Jean-Paul Marat, 3. Ferdinand Lassalle, 4. R. Liebknecht, B. Eugene B. Deb, 6. E. Lenin in preparation. Germany, Thomas Munzer, Karl Marx, Friedrich Engels, Wilhelm Liebknecht, August Babel, France, Georges Danton, Antoine Saint, Just Antoine Fouquier, Tinville, Gracchus, Babiot, the Communards, Auguste Blangy, Louise Michel, Paul Lafargue, Jean Jowers, England, the Chartist, Keir Hardy, William Morris, Ireland, James Connolly, Russia, Michael Bakunin, George Plekhanov, Peter Kropotkin, Vera Sassoula, Poland, Rosa Luxemburg, Austria, Victor Adler, Bulgaria, Peter Blagojev, Italy, Jason Tussaud, Dane, Francesco Ferrer, Pablo Iglesias, China, Sun Yat-sen, United States, Thomas Paine, Francis Rice, Susan B. Anthony, and others, William H. Silva, Sun Tsai, and other early labor leaders, Wendell Phillips, Don Brown, William Lloyd Garrison, Albert Parsons, and other Chicago labor leaders, Johann Most, Daniel DeLeon, Ben Hanford, Jack London, Chad C. Ruthenberg, International Publishers, 381, 4th Avenue, New York. Over other revolutionary voices, Karl Marx, the 18th Premier of Louis Bonaparte, New Revised Translation, -Das, Elected Essays, Friedrich Engels, Peasant War in German, Engels, Lenin, Plekhanov, and others, Karl Marx, J.C. Mann, Thinker, and Revolutionist, E. Island, Elected War.